conference. It's a great honor to be here in Skopje, and it's the first occasion for me to know your country, and I can tell you, you have a very nice country. Thank you. Today I want to tell you about the project of the Romanian government for a Romanian question between the Great Albanian idea and an autonomous Macedonia. Because the time is very expensive here, I cut the introduction, it's better for us. The official instructions for the minister in London regarding the peace talks, drafted in December 1912 by Titu Maiorescu, who held the office of Minister of Foreign Affairs beside that of Prime Minister, made reference to the Romanian question in the first paragraph. In case of a potential participation of Romania to the ambassador meeting, you will seek to defend, above all, the interest of the Romanians. The Romanian ambassador was mandated to endorse two projects, probably depending on the evolution of the talks. In this regard, one can think about an autonomous Macedonia and Albania, eventually of a large as it gets Albania. The experience of the disputes with Greece in the previous years has made the minister emphasis the need that the ambassador was to insist that the Balkan states, and especially Greece, should recognize the Romanian schools and church and allow the establishment of a bishopric. As one can notice, there was no clear strategy from the very beginning, but only a number of suggestions that the ambassador had to adapt according to the progress of the conference talks. During the Balkan Wars and the consequent peace negotiations, three political projects for the Romanians can be distinguished, none of which was to be followed consistently by the Romanian state. Against the background of the sympathy of the first project was the Great Albania. Against the background of the sympathy that the Albanians enjoyed in Romania, the Romanian politicians and the Romanian leaders embraced the idea of creating an Albanian-Romanian state, or that of including the Romanians in a Great Albania, organized under the principle of a confederate state. The project had been initially launched in non-governmental environments and in the media. The idea was then assumed by the Romanian diplomacy, and it enjoyed the support of Bulgaria in the autumn of 1912. For the Bulgarians, a larger Albanian state that was to include the territories inhabited by the Romanians would have eliminated all Greek pretensions. The Romanian ambassador in Sofia, encouraged by the talks with the Bulgarian counterparts, proposed to the Romanian Prime Minister to seek an official endorsement by Bulgaria for the inclusion in the future Albania state of the Romanian living in an area stretching from Macedonia to the Pindus Mountains. The Romanian Prime Minister, after receiving the agreement from King Charles I, presented in a reception for the foreign ambassadors in Bucharest the interest Romania has for a Great Albania with the purpose of supporting the Romanians. A few days later, on the occasion of a meeting with the president of the Bulgarian parliament, Stefan Danev, the Romanian Prime Minister reiterated the wish of Romania for the creation of a large and strong Albania. The Albanian project was equally endorsed inside the ranks of the party in government, the Conservative Party. On the occasion of a gathering of the conservative leaders, of which topic had been the position that Romania was to adopt, a politician asked that Romania advocate the incorporation to Albania of as much as possible from the lands inhabited by the Romanians. The Romanian government was further motivated to support the project of a Great Albania by the candidate to the throne of the future state by the German prince Wilhelm of Wied. The prince was the nephew of Romania's queen, Elizabeth. His enthronement would have enhanced the political influence of Romania in the Balkans. The Romanian ambassador in London received instruction to support the incorporation of a Romanian settlement in the Pindus Mountains from Samarina to Metsovo inside the Albanian borders. In all those places where the Romanians formed the majority, the language of the administration was to be the Romanian, just like in every other Romanian school and church. This general principle was to be inscribed in the new constitution. The Romanian official argued during the ambassador conference of 28 March 1930, for the inclusion to Albania of 36 Romanian settlements with a total population of 80,000 inhabitants. For the preservation of their identity, he asked that the great power were to warrant in the treaty and the constitution the administrative and communal autonomy, and there where this would be possible, also the political autonomy, as well as the freedom of employing the Romanian language in the administration, schools and church, the recognition of an Romanian spiritual leader, and the right of the Romanian government to finance the Romanian cultural institutions without impediments, as was the case until then. At the same time, in mid-March 1913, in Trieste was held a meeting of a number of Romanian and Albanian leaders who, over a period of 3 days, debated the project of an Albanian-Romanian state. The project of a Great Albania, although it enjoyed the support of Italy and Austria-Hungary, was not adopted at the table of negotiation. The second project was the project of the Autonomous Macedonia. Just like in the case of the Great Albania, the idea of an autonomous Macedonian state was not formulated by Romania, which nonetheless assumed it as a backup solution for the Romanians. In the first phase of negotiations between Bulgaria and Serbia, before the start of the war, each had claimed a strip of Macedonian land, while the largest part was going to form an autonomous state according to the early Bulgarian proposals. Greece was against this autonomy, as it considered it only a stage in the future expansion plans of Bulgaria. At some point, under the pressure of the military events, the Turkish proposition for the armistice also contained the project of an autonomous Macedonia. The project for the establishment of a Macedonian state was also for a short while on the diplomatic agenda. Before the war broke out, the Austrian Minister of Foreign Affairs had proposed the creation of an autonomous Macedonia as a solution for avoiding the war. The Macedonian idea did not enjoy influent supporters, as the general opinion was against the project. For instance, a former German diplomat in the Balkans, quoted by the Deutsche Review in January 1913, asserted that the spirit of Macedonian fatherland was absent from Macedonia and that there was no national idea, as was the case among the Albanians. Instead, the Romanian leaders settled in Romania, gathered in the non-governmental organization, the Macedo-Romanian Cultural Society, have promoted the concept of Macedonia to the Macedonians in the central press and through their own publications. In November 1912, appeared a memorandum in French titled Les Macédonies aux Macédoniens, which, in a sense, was a political program for the creation of an autonomous Macedonian state with a confederate structure where each ethnic group was to have equal rights. Since none of the neighboring states can extend and secure their domination over a part of Macedonia without ignoring and overriding the obvious rights of several nations of diverging race and religion, the logical thing to do would be quieting all ideas of conquest and domination and simply adopting the formula of Macedonia to the Macedonians. The authors rightfully foretold that the Balkan allies were soon to clash over the partition of Macedonia. In parallel, a number of actions by the Romanian non-governmental organizations in Romania drew the attention of the Romanian public opinion to the Romanians and backed the project of an autonomous Macedonian state. Mindful of the Romanian public opinion, the Turkish government took up the idea of an autonomous Macedonia and sent to Bucharest at the end of 1912 a member of an Ottoman parliament of Romanian origin, Nicolae Bazaria, with the mission to propose to Romania, among others, the establishment of a local Romanian autonomy in Macedonia under the protectorate of the Romanian state. This was, in fact, a desperate attempt by the Turks to draw Romania into the war against the Christian allies in the Balkans. The Romanian government rejected the Turkish proposal, but the idea of creating an autonomous Macedonian state was assimilated by the Romanian diplomats as a backup plan. On the occasion of a diplomatic reception in 4 December 1912, the Prime Minister, Titu Maiorescu, presented to the foreign envoys accredited to Bucharest Romania's interest for a Great Albanian state, while he also mentioned as a possibility the idea of a Macedonian state, perhaps a Macedonia. In the talks he held with the president of the Bulgarian parliament, the support for a Macedonian state appears also as a backup project, if possible also an autonomous Macedonia. Only on the occasion of the instruction in December 1912 for the Romanian ambassador in London, which I have previously mentioned, the project of an autonomous Macedonia outranks that of Albania. The plan of the Macedonian state as a solution for preserving the character of the Romanian settlements was abandoned by the Romanian government, given that negotiation began for a German prince related to the Royal House of Romania to be brought to the throne of Albania. Moreover, the idea of an Albanian state enjoyed the support of the Greek powers, unlike that of Macedonian state. The Romanian cultural societies in Romania were dissatisfied with the incoherence and lack of determination of the government in Bucharest concerning the Romanians and the Macedonian projects. The criticism was expressed both in the press as well as in a number of public assemblies. Between February and April 1913, a Romanian deputation constituted by George Murnu, Iuliu Valaori and Nicolae Papahagi, having received its mandate from the Macedo-Romanian Cultural Society, toured the capitals of the Greek European powers in order to plead the Romanian cause in the context of the partition of European Turkey between the Balkan states. The delegation was to advocate the political project of an autonomous Macedonian state organized on the model of the Swiss cantons, where every ethnical group would enjoy equal rights. The Romanian government supported this step both at financial and diplomatic level, but without ever involving the Romanian state. The diplomatic representatives of Romania received and introduced the Romanian leaders to the Minister of Foreign Affairs in the countries they visited. The support of the government was only formal, however, prompted by the sympathy of the public opinion at home for the Romanian question, as proof of the petty politics the Romanian government indulged on its report by the Romanian ambassador in Berlin, informing the Prime Minister that the Secretary, German Secretary of State, noted that the autonomy of Macedonia was not in the Romanian plans. Even the European minister that the Romanian deputies met used a double discourse. If the accounts by the delegates denote an official and considerate attitude towards the European ministers, the private letters of George Murnu to his family allow for a more accurate deciphering of the position the European powers shared over the project of an autonomous Macedonia. The Romanian deputation went to Budapest, Vienna, Paris, London, Berlin, and Rome. The heads of the Romanian delegation set meetings between the delegates and the Minister of Foreign Affairs or their substitutes. The Romanians and the Romanians in the visit capital resized them and facilitated their contacts in the diplomatic world and the media. A large number of press conferences for promoting the political project of Macedonia to the Macedonians were organized in Vienna. Baron Macchio, head of department in the Austrian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, hinted that this political idea was something new, deserving his utmost consideration. After this meeting, the Romanian deputies knew that the Romanian government was responsible for the failure of the project because it had not supported it in advance before the European powers. In Paris, they appealed to the feeling of the common Latin origin, asking the French Minister of Foreign Affairs, Lyonard, for this support to the only Latin element in the Balkans. The diplomatic promises by the French made the delegates believe for the moment that their project was on the right tracks. However, on the same day of their reception in Paris, the French ambassador in Vienna had informed the Romanian counterpart that the Romanian project was deprived of any chance of success. Except for the Russian ambassador, the other ambassadors in London received the Romanian deputation and assured it in diplomatic terms of their sympathy of their cause. The following day, mere coincidence, the Romanian ambassador in London was called to the conference to present the position of Romania regarding the incorporation of the territories inhabited by the Romanians in the Pindus-Tolbania orbis. The ambassadors suggested him that the step taken by the Romanian deputation came at the wrong time and recommended that their interest be left in the hands of the Romanian government. The frustration of the Romanian delegates is reflected in the criticism they directed in their private letters at the position adopted by Romania toward this project. Perhaps that even the Romanian ambassador in London, of a Romanian origin, shared their dissatisfaction with respect to Bucharest's attitude. Aware of the impossibility to influence the European governments and frustrated by this failure, they went on to visit Berlin, where they met the German Minister of Foreign Affairs. This one realized that the Romanian deputation action was not reflecting the position of the Romanian government. In the last capital they visited, Rome, the Romanian delegates adjusted to the developments on the negotiations of the conference in London as they presented a different project to the Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs, Di San Giuliano. The memorandum underlined that the best solution for the Romanian question would have been an autonomous Macedonian state, which was impossible to put into practice in those circumstances. As an alternative, the Romanian delegates proposed the creation of an Romanian canton inside of Great Albania, which was to include the Pindus Mountains. Besides the historical, cultural, and economical arguments, the Romanian deputies tried to sensitize the Italian minister by invoking their Latinity. In fact, the delegation assumed the official discourse of the Romanian government, which was interested, as I have shown previously, in the creation of a Great Albanian state, in the prospect of bringing to the throne a German prince, who was also the nephew of the King of Romania. It was the Italian press, rather than the minister, that which responded with enthusiasm to the project presented by the Romanian deputation in Rome. Aware of the failure of the Romanian deputation, George Murnu shed his bitterness about Romania in a letter dispatched to his brother. We have made all that we could to salvage our own. Our idea to form an autonomous Macedonia is unattainable. They all told us it is too late, but what could have we done more when we are not backed by a few hundreds or thousands of bayonets? All buildings with those in Bucharest who did not know how to raise the problem on time, their guilt is today known and recognized by anyone. That Romania has suffered one of the most lamentable defeats is beyond doubt. The frustration of the Romanians in Romania about the actions of the Romanian government was generalized. To the same wave of discontent belonged the assassination attempt in the Romanian parliament. In the first day of April 1930, a young Romanian, Stase Hânciu, seeking to draw the attention of the politicians and the public opinion on the Romanian question, fired his revolver at an important politician, Tache Ionescu, Minister of the Interior, yelling, "Let the Macedonian voice be heard." It was not by chance that the assassination attempt targeted Tache Ionescu. In an earlier intervention in Parliament, he had warned on the weakness of the project concerning the autonomous Macedonia because of the risk of triggering new conflicts between the ethnic groups living in the region. The same politician claimed that the only sustainable support Romania was able to offer the Romanians was obtaining the autonomy of school and church life together with the right for Romania to finance this institution. This was the third way. On the brink of the Second Balkan War in June 1913, the project of an autonomous Macedonian state was brought back on the diplomatic agenda by Romania in the idea of creating a buffer state which was used to limit the territorial expansion of any of the Balkan states. One of the conservative party's leaders, Alexandru Marghiloman, launched this theory before the king, who then asked him to analyze the possibility of warranting the existence of such state. The sovereign commissioned Maiorescu, prime minister, with the task of verifying all the statesmen made by Bulgaria on the issue of the autonomous Macedonia. A few days later, the Romanian prime minister endorsed the project of an autonomous Macedonia before a number of foreign diplomats accredited in Bucharest, but at least the Russian ambassador, Shebeko, objected to the plan, expressing his opinion that this would constitute a preliminary step for a future annexation by Bulgaria. Maiorescu also disputed this project with his party colleague, Tachionescu, as well as the king, presenting it as a backup solution, perhaps an autonomous Macedonia, extra security for the Kosovlaks. After the war broke out, the first peace proposal offered by the Romanian side to Bulgaria comprised the intention to draft a protocol concerning Macedonia. The negotiations were later to embrace other options, of which the project of a Macedonian state would not part of, neither as a political solution for the Romanians, nor as a buffer for the territorial expansion of the Balkan state. The third way was an illusion of success of Romanian diplomacy. The latter change between Prime Minister of Romania with Prime Minister of Serbia, Bulgaria and Greece about the autonomy of school, but this was an illusion. Thank you very much.
Во моментов заврши излагањето на колегата Мариус Диаконеску од Букурешкиот факултет, поточно Универзитет, факултетот за историја. Неговата работа се однесуваше на неколку критички забелешки на улогата на Романија за време на Балканските војни, но сепак во текстот провејува реалноста. Тоа е моментот кога барем во европски рамки делуваат две сили. Едната сила е Антантата, во која што се Русија, Франција и Велика Британија, и имаат свои намери кон политиките на балканските земји. Другата страна се централните сили, каде што се Австро-Унгарија, Германија и Италија, и кои што исто така имаат свои намери кон балканските земји. Од тука улогата што ја добива Романија во таа дипломатска, па и стратешка, поточно стратешка линија на европско тло, да биде местото на одржување на конференција на
keeping that is hosting conferences during which issues regarding the Balkan state and Macedonia will be settled.
The Romanian soldier fought with peasants, with old grandmas,
keeping cattle and considering themselves as being major warriors, and thus they entered the war. So Romania thought that they were very important in a diplomatic matter. However, when it comes to the Dobrucha issue between Romania and Bulgaria, are even today active and are finalized with the statement that the unresolved issue in between Macedonia and Romania is still quite active. If there are any questions for Marius. I come from the Faculty of Philosophy from Skopje. I have a very short question. He expressed very interesting data as regards to the requests of the Vlach population, the Romanians, for Macedonian autonomy. Can you identify the archive sources from which you extracted this data? Because I carry out a lot of research, not in particular the Vlach population, but the Macedonian question, especially the period from the Balkan Wars until 1941. So can you just please identify the sources and the archives? Thank you.
The archive of Minister of Foreign Affairs in Bucharest. There is a lot of reports about the Macedonian question. Of course, the Romanian authority insisted about the Romanian questions. First of all, this was the first idea. After that was the general question of Macedonia. If you need some more information and you need my our help to access it, you are welcome to Bucharest anytime.